session, the Honorable Dan Goodell presiding.
Please be seated. Is the messaging back up yet?
No, it's still on.
Okay, we are on the record. This is the Mason County Superior Court. This is Judge Dan Goodell. This is the bench trial of Angela Voss and Bobby Knight, cause number 20-3-178-23. It is streaming live on the Zoom channel as well as participants present in the courtroom. We had set this additional session based upon the court's request to have the guardian ad litem to investigate a limited issue. The court did receive a report from the guardian ad litem based upon the court's order. That report is dated June 13th, 2021. It actually says June 13th, 2020, and we'll have to clarify that with the guardian ad litem. So, Ms. Voss, did you receive a copy of the report?
I did, Your Honor.
And Mr. Knight, did you receive
a copy? Yes, I did.
Okay. Ms. Johnson is in the Zoom channel right now, but she's in the waiting room right now?
Your Honor, it was my understanding she was going to be here in person. I didn't send her exhibits electronically because that was my understanding based on what she had said.
Okay, so you have exhibits for her to review?
Correct.
Okay, well, I think that what happened here is I authorized her appearing by Zoom, not realizing that there would be anything beyond what she had reviewed as part of her report. But I'm not making any ruling on anything because I don't think that'd be appropriate at this time. So it sounds to me that if you have exhibits for her to review and she doesn't have them, we have one of two ways of going. One, we continue this matter to have you give you the opportunity to send those to her so she has those exhibits. Or two, we just continue this matter to have her appear in person. But either way, without her ability to review your exhibits, it mm-hmm. sounds like, and I need to clarify the record. You have exhibits that you are going to be proposing that are not already admitted, correct?
Correct.
And these exhibits are related to the limited issue of the subsequent or most recent guardian litem investigation, is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. And I don't have, instant messaging is down today, so I'm not connected to court administration. Okay, so Ms. Johnson, this is Judge Goodell. Can you hear me okay?
I can. Good morning.
Good morning. Ms. Johnson, I authorize you to appear via the Zoom channel this morning as a follow-up in the trial of Voss and Knight to address any additional questions to be raised by the parties related to your supplemental report. One thing I did not consider at that time is that there would be a potential of exhibits that were not within the realm of what I was aware of you reviewing at the time. And it appears that we do have some exhibits that that Ms. Voss indicates that you do not have copies of right now. And as a result, it doesn't look like we're going to be able to proceed today after all. So what I want to do this morning, however, then, if that's the case, is that we need to schedule a time where you can be available. And I think it's probably appropriate given, are those the exhibits right there?
Yes.
Given the, what appears to be the extent of the proposed exhibits, that you be present at the time of the hearing or the trial. So, probably the best way to deal with that would be to bring court administration online. I also know that there were some subpoenas, or a subpoena, I think it was one.
Two.
Okay, a subpoena that also went out, and therefore today, and those would be in person. Are you anticipating any issues about going ahead with those subpoenas without hearing from the guardian ad litem first?
One, I have confirmed that she will be testifying at 11, and the other has not responded no matter how many phone calls I make to Mason General. So I don't know the status of that. I also have Dr. Langer coming. On this specific issue at 1:30. He's got limited availabilities, so I don't have a problem with having them testify today.
Okay.
But
I have
not
a question
sure
concerning Dr. Langer. Why would Dr. Langer be involved in this? Because this is just a very short investigation into why Ms. Voss took Chloe off of medication. I don't understand why Dr. Langer would even be involved in this.
Well, we can deal with that in a moment, but Ms. Johnson, this is what I'm suggesting, is that, that we do have some other witnesses that will be appearing today, and then we won't know how we'll progress until after we get through today's session. So what I'm going to suggest is that we'll just work through court administration to schedule a time. If you could contact Rochelle at court administration, let her know what your availability would be next week and the following week. That would be a good starting point for us in our discussions.
Okay, I will do that, Your Honor.
Okay, and so then with that, we'll go ahead and excuse you from testimony today, and then we will follow up on that, okay?
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Regard to Dr. Langer, there was a, as I understand it, Ms. Voss, you just indicated that you are intending on have him appear this afternoon.
Yes.
To testify. And I just want to make sure the record's clear. The only issue that the court has allowed to move forward, because both both parties have rested. Is the issue related to the most recent investigation by the guardian ad litem? Okay. And as an offer of proof, are you anticipating that Dr. Langer will be, you're intending to offer Dr. Langer's testimony and that that testimony is relevant to the investigation by Ms. Johnson?
Yes.
Okay. And so as an offer of proof, I don't need to have you say this is what you expect him to say, but just as a general explanation as to what areas that you anticipate him to be testifying to.
He previously testified that he's done extensive studies. I can't recall if he actually obtained a degree in psychopharmacology. He testified about the medication and about Mr. Knight asked him questions about my fears about the medication, and he reviewed Ms. Johnson's report and her opinions and the medical records and has a different opinion to offer.
Okay, the issue is going to be foundation, okay, but Mr. Knight, anything further?
Yeah, I would have to object because this is all, we had discussed this medication with Dr. Langer and had opportunity to question during his testimony. This has all been discussed during the trial. If Ms. Voss wanted to have more conversation about around that medication, she should have done it at that point. She's rested her case.
So the court is going to allow you to present Dr. Langer take the stand. I do think that given your offer of proof that it potentially is relevant to this particular case if he did a review. Again, the court's going to be focusing on foundation. Okay.
Question about that foundation being Ms. Johnson has to testify as to her report, or mm-hmm. we can...
Foundation of Dr. Langer's ability to provide testimony in the areas that you'll be asking questions.
Okay.
And so foundation is just that, is okay. What is his ability to provide an opinion, because you'll be offering him as an expert witness. Okay. So previously, he was utilized as your therapist and provided a combination of things, of factual and to a degree some expert testimony as well. As I'm hearing things right now, he's purely expert at this point as far as an offer goes. And so we'll have to hit the standard of laying the foundation to qualify him to do that. Okay. Okay. Further housekeeping issues. This court is swearing in its new judge at this afternoon, which means that this court will not be able to proceed beyond 3 o'clock today in order to prepare for the swearing-in ceremony. Without Ms. Johnson testifying today, then it would not be appropriate to move to closing arguments anyway. And now I'm hearing that we have another witness at 1:30. So I just want everybody to know that at 3 o'clock we will have to stop the proceeding today. We will need to work with the court administration on a time for Ms. Johnson to testify. As the parties know, we've talked about this many, many times. I'm now in the criminal rotation that was available today. However, each week is based upon what's happening that week. So we will work through that. Okay, and then I did some reviews of some exhibits, and there were two exhibits that were on my list to get back to the parties on and to make the record clear on. They relate to exhibits 395C and 320A. And begin with 395C. And I'll wait till you're ready.
I didn't staple it.
I have one. You've already offered it up. Okay. I mean, you created it. I listened to the proceedings of the date in question, which was May 5th. And I understand what the confusion was. Okay, so what happened is that on May 5th, Ms. Voss offered portions of Exhibit 395. And then what the court did is that the court considered that offer, and there was no objection to the pages. What happened is that there was a discussion about the page numbers. And what started out as a discussion of page 3 was actually a discussion of page 2. Ultimately, I went back to looked at my notes. I wrote down pages 3, 4, and 5. And on the record, I said that the court was admitting 3, 4, and 5 as 395C. And that's 3, 4, and 5 of the larger proposed exhibit 395. Ms. Voss went and then prepared that exhibit and offered it up. I looked at the exhibit, compared it to the larger exhibit of 395, and recognized what was offered or was prepared was pages 2, 3, and 4, not 3, 4, and 5. So that is what my comment was. Well, no, we're supposed to have 5, we're supposed to start on 3. At the time that I admitted, I made an error. On the record, I had written down and I said pages 3, 4, and 5. But what was being referenced in the offer was actually pages 2, 3, and 4. So the court made an error on the record, and that is why when Ms. Voss, you offered up, which was the correct exhibit, I was concerned about it because it began on page 2. You prepared page 2, 3, and 4 because those were the pages that everybody was talking about. I just made the error of admitting 3, 4, and 5. So, Madam Clerk, we need to correct. Exhibit 395C. No, I already have it in my hands. You don't need to get it. You just need to make note that 395C is pages 2, 3, and 4 of Exhibit 390, or proposed Exhibit 395. Any questions, Ms. Voss?
Can you identify that? Is
yes.
that the email?
It begins with
the
email from yourself to Joseph Darbro, dated September 20th, 2021 at 2:35.
September
20th, 2021 at 2:35 p.m. That's page 1. Page 2 has at the top an attendance record, screenshot, and then below that is an email from Mr. Knight to Ms. Johnson, and then below that is an email from Ms. Powell to Mr. Knight, and those are both dated March 26, 2021. And then the final page at the top is the remainder of the Kimberly Powell email, and at the bottom of that page is a email from Ms. Voss to Mr. Click, dated September 24th, 2021. So those are the three pages that are 395C, and as I indicated, those are the three pages that you offered up as 395C.
Okay, so
okay,
my copy of 395C in my hand is completely wrong, too. This has been just, yeah. Thank you for clarifying that.
Okay, and then page 5 of 395 was not admitted, and it is not admitted. give the clerk back $395, and then I'm also going to give the clerk the new exhibit 395C, if you would please mark that, Madam Clerk.
All I have to do is read it, correct?
Yeah, just mark it.
Just mark it.
Okay.
Yes, for all.
Okay, the next exhibit that was left for my review was exhibit 320A. And Ms. Voss did prepare 320A and provided it to the court. 320A is that portion of 320 which was the calendar on our family wizard. And the calendar portion of 320A was that portion of the of 320, which was admitted by the court. However, it was admitted for only a limited purpose. And the limited purpose was for proof of the entries of appointments made by Mr. Knight. That's the sole purpose. And when the actual 320A was presented to the court to have marked, question was raised as to the purpose and extent of this exhibit. So I went back and reviewed my notes, and that was a limited purpose only to show what appointments had been placed on the calendar by Mr. Knight that were in 320. So that was just a clarification, nothing changes. I just wanted to be able to clarify 320A and the offered 320A made by Ms. Knight is appropriate. So I'll have the clerk mark that one as well.
And just so the record's clear, it's Ms. Voss.
I'm sorry. I don't know what it is that causes my mind to do that.
It's going to be so hard reading through it.
Okay. So we are then left what I believe is Exhibit 369.
I have others in my stack here that I'll ask about, but
okay, because that's the only one on my list right now.
Okay,
but, it could be that there's something else that I don't have on my list. But
right.
369 was a exhibit that was that had highlights in it, and the only correction of that was just to take the highlights out.
Right, right. Good to clean copies. What I did.
Yeah. highlights in this one?
Still highlights in it.
I guess so.
Okay.
I'm sorry, they're highlighted on my screen and I thought I printed it, but that turned off.
Okay. We'll readdress that later. Okay, and so do you have other exhibits that you believe needed to be updated, Ms. Voss?
Yes. I had prepared, and I don't know if it's already been resolved or if my notes are not accurate on those. But I have 339A. I don't know what the issue was that I would have.
I don't have a 339A.
No,
you know what date?
Just 39A.
Oh, 39.
And I believe the issue was there were two orders, both in Exhibit 39.
Yeah, 39A is not to include the first two pages.
And so there were two separate orders, and the result being the one order dated November 16th, and the order, the other order that was attached in, also in Exhibit 39 was not included. And so maybe that was the first two pages.
That's what I meant to say. Could you pull 39, please? Okay, and so the, according to my notes, the two pages that are not included are, relate to a contempt order, but there, it looks like there's two contempt orders that were entered on the same date. And the two pages that are not included, according to my notes, is the one under subsection 4 where it says on phrase 1, the moving party has not established contempt. Then we have the other contempt order dated the same date, and that is a 5-page document. And it has a contempt money judgment summary on the front, and it shows a civil penalty, Bobby Knight, as the debtor's name and $100 amount. So that would be, that is correct then. That would be from that entire document, 5 pages, is the 39A. So if that's what you have prepared?
Yes.
Okay, could you show it to Mr. Knight?
Yes.
All right.
Anything, any issues with this, Mr. Knight?
I didn't see any issues.
Okay, so 39A shall be marked. It's already been amended. Maybe I'll sit back, regular 39. Okay, and you have another exhibit.
I'm wondering about 359A.
359A?
Correct.
There needs to be a 359A, yes, and so I do have notes about what that should be.
Okay.
Okay.
And so I've got page 7 of 25 and page 8 of 25.
That would be correct. Can you show it to Mr. Knight, please? Any objections or
no
issues? Okay. So the 359A is correct as presented. That this needs to be marked. It's already been admitted. Okay. Do you have another exit?
I have 396A here, but I'm not sure if I just accidentally grabbed it. Is 396A complete?
Well, I have highlights on 396A, and I have the same highlight was on 395C, so I'm anticipating the fact that it was highlighted means that there was something that needs to be done on it. Madam Clerk, if you could pull first of all, see if there is a 396A. I don't think there is, but take a look and pull 399.
Did we do 369?
Three what?
69. That's also what it was highlighted. I have 369.
How about
you? Do you want 396?
396. And there is no 396A.
I did not.
You want to check?
No, 395A.
So that is correct. We need a 396A.
And should I identify what I have?
Yes, would you please?
Okay. It begins with an Our Family Wizard message sent 315 of 22 with attachments. They're from Seattle Children's portal. There's several pages of portal information. I'm not sure. And then there are some Our Family Wizard messages behind that dated 3/16/22 and 3/31/22. And that 3/31/22 is actually three pages long.
Right. So it does not include the, there's a email, two page is after, well, it's two pages and it's, the heading at the top says Rice Night - Antidepressant, and it's from yourself to Mr. Click, dated April 5th, 2022. I believe that that and the subsequent page are the ones that were not included in 396. And so 396 has everything except for those two pages.
Right. 396A, yes.
Yes, that's right. Okay. Let me show it to Mr. Knight.
No objection.
So 396A has already been admitted and just needs to be marked. Okay, and do you have another exhibit?
I do. I've got 399A.
399A?
Yes.
That 399A is pages 2 and 3 of 399 without third party.
Right. And so I crossed out the portions that are not to be considered.
Okay. And so those are pages 2 and 3 of the former 399 then?
I believe so, yes.
Okay. I'm going to show it to Mr. Knight.
No objection.
Okay, so 399A was previously admitted and is now being marked with the redacted portions noted. Give you back 399 as well. And 396. Boss, do you have any other?
I don't have any in my pile, but I don't know that I've gotten everything.
Did we do 90? Or not, it'd be 90A. And 90B. Madam Clerk, could you pull up? Maybe, I think we might have already, I think we might have split that. Pull 90, see if there's a 90A and a 90B.
I
So 90A was, one second, take a look at one more thing. Okay. So what happened is that 90A was offered, 90B was admitted. So 90A is a portion of 90, which includes a screenshot of a, what appears to be text messages between Hayden and Mr. Knight. That was not admitted. The other two pages of 90A were admitted, and they were admitted as 90B because we needed to maintain 90A as presented, okay, which was not admitted, okay. So I will need to have the two pages, 90B, prepared, Ms. Voss, and that begins with, at the top, it's an our family wizard document. At the top, it says, generated September 9th, 2021 at 11:09 by Angela Voss. And it includes a email chain, the top one being September 9th, 2021 at 7:36 from Ms. Voss to Mr. Knight. And then the chain just continues after that. Okay, you know which those are then?
Yes.
So I will need to have that as a 90B.
Sitting next to my desk.
Okay. He's back. Clerk, would you see if that has been provided? Just need to find out whether that was set. Okay, well, in looking at my notes and then going back through the list of exhibits from our last, no, it wasn't our last session, it was the, yeah, it was our last session, June 3rd. I believe that that catches us up, and so looks to me like we are only missing the 90B and the 369. According to my notes and the notes of the clerk. And Ms. Voss, if you could provide both of those, then that will catch us up. Is there any other exhibit that you're aware of, Ms. Voss, that needs to be updated?
Not that I'm aware of.
How about you, Mr. Knight?
No, I don't.
Okay. Okay, well, you whittled it down, so we're getting there.
And is Ms. Bolander on Zoom?
I do have somebody on Zoom. Bolander?
Yes.
Okay. I will let, is it Ms. Bolander? Okay.
Yes.
Let Ms. Bolander in. Okay. This is the Mason County Superior Court. This is Judge Dan Goodell. Do I have Ms. Bolander on the Zoom channel?
Yes, you do.
Okay, Ms. Bolander, would you please unblock your video screen or your video?
Absolutely.
Okay, and you can hear me okay?
I can, thank you.
Okay. Madam Clerk, we need to have that screen up. In just a moment, Ms. Bolander, as we work through our electronic.
I'm going to close my door too. I'm close.
Okay, and then you need to mute that screen as well. There you go. Okay. So I do have you up on the screen in the courtroom now. And,
okay.
Okay. And can everybody hear her okay?
It's light. I could.
Okay. So, Ms. Bolander, you've been called to testify in the matter of Angela Voss and Bobby Knight in, here in the Mason County Superior Court. And so I am going to swear you in, and then I'll allow... Ms. Voss to inquire. Okay? Please raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
I do.
Okay. And I'd like to have you begin by, sorry, now I'm playing with the camera. I'd like to have you begin by stating your name and spelling your last name for the record.
Okay, Doris Bolander. And that is B-O-L-E-N-D-E-R.
Okay. And Ms. Bolander has previously testified in this matter. Is that correct?
That's correct.
Okay. So, Ms. Bolander, I'm going to remind you that you are still under oath. Okay?
Okay.
Ms. Knight, you may continue. You may inquire.
Ms. Voss, thank you, Your Honor.
Ms. Voss, yes, please continue.
Thank you. Good morning, Ms. Bolander. Did you
receive... Good morning.
Okay, the volume got really loud on that again. did you receive the email I sent you this morning with exhibits, in exhibit number
yes.
444?
Yes.
Thank you. I'd like to... I've got my own bench copy of 444.
Clear.
It's a proposed exhibit?
It is.
Proposed exhibit.
And Mr. Knight has a copy as well.
You may continue.
Thank you. And so you're testifying in response to the subpoena abusus tecum that you received, which is the first part of exhibit 444, is that correct?
That is correct.
Thank you. And I know I had asked Mr. Moore to testify in response to statements that the guardian ad litem had made in her most recent report. And it was my understanding that Mr. Moore would not be able to make himself available to testify. Is that correct?
I'm supposing that. I wasn't part of that conversation, but he did.
Objection.
He did say that he would make the restatement.
Calling for presumption on the witness. She don't have. She's asking if about somebody else's abilities. She can, should only ask what Ms. Bolander can do, not what Mr. Moore can do.
Well, I think my concern is that there's some speculation going on here. She that's what she said.
And
so.
She almost finished what she was saying before she was interrupted there.
Okay, so I will reserve my ruling on that. And Ms. Bolin, would you answer that question again, please?
Yes, I'm just not clear of what Mr. Moore's ability or that is. Wasn't part of the conversation. I did ask him to make us to put it in writing for me. And so that is a brief response to what a statement or concern that had been expressed by Ms. Foss regarding the guardian ad litem. And I did tell him what was shared with me and ask him to put something in writing.
And are you the custodian of records for the school district?
I am.
Okay. And is this statement that Mr. Moore had written included immediately after the subpoena deuces tecum in exhibit 444?
After my subpoena, yes.
Yes. And the other records here, the academic history for Hayden with progress grades and academic history for Rice with grades and teachers' comments on behavior, citizenship, etc. Several pages of that. And then do you also have
objection foundation for to the GAL's report? This is going way beyond the scope of what was said in the GAL report.
At this point, we're just identifying documents, so I'll allow you to continue to identify documents, and then we will hear what is being offered. And then I need to clarify the record. I reserve an objection. The objection was based upon speculation. The witness was able to reflect what it is that was within her knowledge, and so I'm going to overrule that objection. Okay, so continue identifying documents.
Thank you, Your Honor. And after the academic portions, do you see emails, the first being titled Rice Night, dated May 16th of 2020?
Correct.
And then an incident with Rice on Monday is the next email from May 9th, 2022.
Correct.
And then another Rice Night from April 26th, 2022.
Correct.
And accommodations dated February 25th, 2022.
Correct.
and possible meetings, Hayden Rice Night, January 28th, 2022?
Correct.
Okay, and do these all reflect records maintained by the district or district records?
I'm sorry, do these all reflect what was the?
Pioneer School District records as the custodian of the district records, are these all within?
These are all from Pioneer School District, yes.
Okay, I'd like to offer the exhibit.
Mr. Knight, exhibit 444 has been offered, any objections?
I believe this is way beyond the scope of what was investigated. It was merely a comment by Mr. Moore that was put into the Guardian Lighten's report. Ms. Voss is now trying to add more evidence to the case. It's already been closed. This is way beyond scope. There's she has emails in here that could have been put in while evidence was still being accepted.
So the objection is beyond scope. And your response, Ms. Voss, there's several documents in here, so
right.
Maybe you should start with the first one.
Okay. And so the subpoena is obviously describing what I'm requesting from the district, specifically related to statements within Ms. Johnson's report. And specifically addressing the issues she raises. The statement regarding the guardian ad litem from Mr. Moore is fairly self-evident in that he's responding to that report. The grades of the children is something that Ms. Johnson touched on, specifically regarding Rice.
Specifically, I don't recall the report going involving, first of all, the order had an investigation with regard to Rice, Chloe, and the medication and actions that were taken regarding that medication. How does the grades of Hayden relate to that?
It may not. It was the records I obtained and, you know, put in here. It relates to another issue, but not specifically to this report. Sort of. The grades of Rice definitely do. Hayden would be related to Mr. Knight's statement about something else.
That the guardian litem investigated the court's order?
No, the records regarding Hayden might not relate, is what I'm saying.
Okay, and you understand the scope of this proceeding at this point?
I understand, and so I should not have inadvertently included those, and that was an oversight.
Okay, so we have a document called Academic History for Hayden Knight, which, that's the first page of it. The second page deals with trimester grades.
Trimester.
And the next page as well. And then there is a page of Pioneer Middle School, it's a student, and it has classes, more grades on it regarding Hayden. And so those are 1, 2, 3, 4 pages that are specifically related to Hayden that are not relevant and will not be included. Okay. So we have grades of Chloe, creates her records, I guess, 1, 2, 3, 4 pages as well. And then how does this relate to the limited scope?
Ms. Johnson's report, as I recall, includes an alleged statement from Mr. Moore about Rice's behavior throughout the school year and 504, and 504 obviously being intended to support them academically. And so the specific statements for trimester 1, 2, and 3 relate to.
Could you refer the court to what you're referring to in the report?
Sure. And so I've got the report as exhibit 438.
Okay.
And on page 3 is the portion where Ms. Johnson states that she had inquired, I'm sorry, around lines 4 through 13 is what I'm kind of looking at here. Asking about Chloe's behaviors and whether or not they changed in the past few months. And so, since starting the antidepressant, and so for context, we've got, I'm sorry, because his response on line 7-8 is, these behaviors have been exhibited throughout the school year, and that he wished Chloe would use the 504 plan accommodations that are available. So what I'm looking at here in the report cards relates to behavior, citizenship, failing to hand in work, the comments from the teachers throughout the school year, and whether or not there is a change noted. That would support the alleged statement by Mr. Moore.
And so where is there a document within this these academic records of Chloe Rice that reference behaviors exhibited through the school year?
Yeah, behaviors exhibited through the school year is really vague. And so these trimester 1, 2, and 3 reports have teacher comments. For example, on trimester 1, we've got advisory T. Smith, satisfactory citizenship. And so behaviors, because it's such a vague statement, looking for anything that might be applicable. And there was prior testimony as to what those behaviors were. Participating, interfering, paying attention.
Which page are you referring to that has relevant information related to this portion of the investigation?
So, all four of these academic pages regarding Rice, I believe, are relevant. The first being overall grade. And what classes they're taking. As I previously testified, Rice has been placed in a intro to STEM with Mr. Smith throughout the entire school year, and if that is a trigger for them in school and this medication is exacerbating it, all of the contributing factors to this medication.
Do you have, as an offer of proof, testimony that's going to tie these documents to the guardian ad litem's investigation and opinion?
I intend to, once it's submitted, yes. I don't know that Ms. Bolander has a lot of, well, I'm going to inquire as to what Ms. Bolander knows about some of these identified issues. Oh, I'm sorry, there was an additional statement in Ms. Johnson's report that Mr. Moore commented that he feels Ms. Voss enables Chloe to not use the school's accommodations that are in place to help Chloe. Mr. Moore added he thinks Chloe does not like living with Mr. Knight because he provides more structure and has expectations for Chloe. And so this information is requested to respond to those alleged statements.
With regard to these documents, and I'm talking about 1, 2, 3, 4 pages of, in essence, academic documents that are grades of Chloe, Mr. Knight, any further objections?
Yes. If Ms. Voss is allowed to slip on, allowed any leadway on any of this stuff, this is gonna, we're already in 19 days on this trial, and it looks like she's trying to put us in, continue forever. The scope of the investigation was around if it was appropriate for Ms. Voss to take Chloe off of medication. Why is, Ms. Voss now pulling in academic records that we've already submitted everything we have from every provider and caregiver, including school stuff. We are now here having a specific investigation, and Ms. Voss is going back pulling more academic stuff that she didn't get in before to put it in. I believe it's way beyond scope, and it's just a ploy to continue the court hearings.
I'm not the one that roped Mr. Moore into this with these claims. I'm responding to Ms. Johnson's report, or attempting to, which may have gone beyond the scope of what the court asked her to look at It's there.
Well, what the court's grappling with is the guardian ad litem's ability by preparing a report to broaden the scope of the court's order. And I can appreciate Ms. Voss's desire to be able to respond to something that that she anticipates the court's going to be considering. Issue really right now is, did the guardian ad litem go beyond the scope? And if she did go beyond the scope, should that be allowed? And then secondly, if it is allowed, then should Ms. Voss have the ability to rebut? Okay. And what we lack right now is the guardian ad litem. Unfortunately, the way things played out today precluded us from exploring this very issue. And so I think for today's purposes, what we're going to do is the court will reserve its ruling with regard to information that Ms. Voss is offering that addresses, in essence, the conversation with Mr. Moore. And until after the guardian ad litem has had an opportunity to testify. But what needs to be allowed to happen is that that Ms. Voss be given the opportunity to be able to lay the foundation to have documents admitted, so that if the court does allow for the scope to address that, that she would be able to utilize these. And we have a witness before us right now who is someone who has been qualified to address what is in the records at Pioneer School District. And so I'm going to allow Ms. Voss to continue. Well, actually, I'm going to go back to Mr. Knight about the next documents. But at this point, the academic records of Chloe Rice Knight, which is that four pages within this exhibit, are reserved pending the court's ruling as to the scope of the report prepared by the guardian ad litem. Okay, so that gets us to a series of emails. And are these all the same chain?
No.
They are. Okay. So let's deal with the first chain, which at the top it says, top left it says Rice Knight, and it's dated May 16th.
Yes.
Is that one page the completion of that chain?
It is.
Okay. So, so what is the relevance of this document?
This is a communication between Ms. Bolander and myself on May 16th being the Monday following the walk-in clinic where Rice did not attend school Monday. Their attendance in school was withheld for a couple of days, as I had spoken with the acting principal, Ms. Van Marter? Is that correct? Ms. Van Marter?
She wasn't, she's admin support, not, I'm the principal.
Right, but you were out of district, and I'm sorry, I thought she identified herself as the acting principal on that day.
Admin support, but that's okay. That's all right.
Thank you for the clarification. So I had a conversation with Ms. Van Marter, and Ms. Bolander followed up a little bit about what was going on with Rice related to medication. The next email.
Wait a second. And so this is your communications with the school on Monday, May 16th are relevant because?
Because Rice that was the day that Rice's attendance was withheld because they were having side effects from the medication, and we had been directed by the walk-in clinic to titrate them off. And so I had a conversation with Ms. Van Murder about what Rice was experiencing in terms of having thoughts about blood and wanting to see blood, hurting others or themselves to see blood. And so I was just trying to keep the school in the loop on this is what's going on. And
so the relevance was that you were keeping the school in the loop?
Correct, correct. It, you know, regarding my actions around this medication,
okay,
that's one of my actions.
Any further objection on this, Mr.?
No, I don't even object to that.
Okay, so the page that is the email chain of May 16th is admitted. It will be included in the admission when we get done. Okay.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Okay.
And
then
so,
the next
right,
officer.
It's a witness and,
oh,
and her attorney.
Well,
okay.
Well.
Okay. You may proceed. The next page is a document that's, is it just one page on this chain as well?
Incident with Rice Monday, yes. And again, this is communication between myself and Mr. Moore, contrary to what Ms. Johnson had written about, you know, keeping in contact with the school, Rice's behaviors while on the medication, as I previously testified. Rice got into trouble a couple of times in school for the first time that I was aware of, and so the emails are related, this email and some others are related to that.
Any further objections to the email chain of May 9th and 10th, Mr.
Knight? No objection.
Okay. So that will be included admitted document. April 26 is the next page. Is that looks again to be a single page email chain?
Correct, Your Honor. And again,
and
this
and
is
that similar to what you just commented
right,
on.
Right. Rice just started this new medication, so just keeping the school in the loop.
Okay.
No objection.
Okay. So that page would be included in the admitted document. And then we have another one that's indicated February 25th, 2022.
No objection.
I want to find out, first of all, is that part of the next page email chain or is that separate?
Separate.
Okay, and there's no objection. So that page will be admitted. And then we have email, and that does appear to be a two-page chain that begins January 28th and ends on January 31st, and is that the same basis?
This
is
regarding the school accommodations that are discussed with Mr. Moore's conversation. Yes.
Okay, so this has to do with the IEP 504 plan?
Right.
Okay.
No objection.
Okay. Well, I'm going to reserve. Okay, so the last two pages of the proposed exhibit are reserved. And so, to clarify, the first four pages are the subpoena. Are you intending to include these in the exhibit? I do recognize that some people just have that part of their exhibit showing the basis.
Well, part of it is in my line of questioning, and if I need to actually... Yes, my intent is to put it in the exhibit because I have a specific question where I requested something and there is nothing because, yeah.
Okay, I understand. Any objections to the first several pages of the subpoena, Mr. Knight?
Pardon?
Any objections to including the first several pages, which is the subpoena?
No objection.
Okay. We have a, statement regarding GAL, that is, dated, 6/15/2022. And, I'm gonna reserve on that as well. Okay, so that page, the statement regarding GAL is reserved. The academic records of Hayden are, not included. They are, the objection sustained. The academic records of Chloe Rice, are reserved. The email chains, that have, may begin at the top of the page, May 16th, May 9th, April 26th, February 25th will be admitted. The last two pages, which are the, is the email chain, beginning January 28th, 2022 is reserved. Those that are admitted at this time will be admitted as 444A. And you'll need to follow up on those that are reserved. Those that potentially are admitted in the future would be a designated different number.
Okay.
So you may continue with this witness.
So the reserved, it will be 444B?
I'm anticipating that, but
okay.
I don't know what's going to happen next.
Okay. And then C would just be not admitted. And just the first four pages of the subpoena, you said admitted or reserved?
I'll allow for the admission.
Okay.
That'll be under the same 444A.
Thank you. Okay. And so, Ms. Bolander, if you're still with us, sir, what involvement have you had regarding Rice's behavior and just Rice's behavior and concerns in that area at school?
Let's pause for a moment.
Oh, we're not on that.
We're
so.
Dealing with focus right now, okay? And that's my concern right now is that you're wanting to go into areas that the court never intended to go. Okay.
Gotcha.
Right. And so I'm reserving to get the guardian ad litem up, and I'm wondering whether we need to potentially recall Ms. Bolander after the guardian ad litem.
I think that would be appropriate, especially with another witness.
Unless you're dealing with Ms. Bolander very specific to the scope of what the court was looking to.
Well, specifically regarding the medication and my actions.
Right, and so what I'm wondering if
but we can do that later too.
That's what I was wondering is that let's refine the scope before we have Ms. Bolander testify.
Okay.
I think that otherwise there may be a lot of testimony that ultimately the court's not going to consider.
Okay.
Is there any other exhibits that you wanted Ms. Bolander to speak to as far as laying foundation for the admission?
This is 444 is the only exhibit I provided.
Okay.
Certainly they have a copy of the guardian ad litem, but that's not for them.
Okay. So Ms. Bolander, because of the way that the morning worked out, we were unable to have one witness appear that was a necessary witness to actually to address some of the areas of questioning that Ms. Voss may have. And so as a result, we're not able to proceed with your testimony today. But, and so you will still be under subpoena, but Ms. Voss will contact you on scheduling a time that works with your schedule for any potential follow-up testimony, okay?
Okay, that would be fine.
And just to clarify, because this is summer, is your contact information on the school email still good?
I probably, because I am retiring here and leaving town pretty quick. I'm just not sure, you know, the best way as far as contacting me. When, is there any time or date or anything that we would be looking at, or we, or it's all unknown?
It's unknown at this point, okay? And so we will try to get that clarified, hopefully by the end of the day. At this point, we don't have a date, Ms. Bolander. So is your contact information good at least through the next several days?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, well then with that, Ms. Bolander, we're going to excuse you for today. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much.
Uh-huh, you're welcome.
Okay, she's now out of the session. It appears that you have a witness who's been subpoenaed who has an attorney with her.
Yes.
Okay, so, and what is the name of your witness?
I believe it would be Therese Pizzanti, the medical provider who prescribed the medication.
Officer, would you please have her come in? Okay, and are you Ms. Pizzanti?
I am.
Okay. You're being called as a witness. Mr. Johnson, you're here on her behalf?
I'm on behalf of the other possible district, number one.
Okay. So, you're being called as a witness. Would you please step up? Okay. And before stepping up, would you please raise your right hand? You solemnly swear affirm the testimony about to give will be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth?
Yes.
Please come up and have a seat. I'd like to have you begin by stating your name and spelling your last name for the record.
Sure. Therese Pizzanti. It is P-I-Z-A-N-T-I.
Okay. Ms. Voss, you may inquire.
Thank you, Your Honor. Ms. Pizzanti, first and foremost, I'd like to apologize for dragging you in here. I understand this is not what you probably wanted to be doing today, and I really appreciate your time. Did you receive the letter I sent you with the attached or enclosed confidential report of the guardian ad litem?
I did.
I'd like to request Exhibit 438, please.
438.
Received?
Yes, I have a copy of that.
Thank you. And so, let's get the records out of the way here real quick. I enclosed some medical records from Mason Clinic in my letter to you. Can you please have Exhibit 439, please? Are the records that I sent to you? Did they look familiar?
Yes. Two of them are my records, one is not my record, it is a record from the walk-in clinic.
Okay. And did they appear to be true, correct copies of missing, general records?
Yes.
And can you identify the dates of those records, please?
The first date is March the 29th. The second date is May the 4th. And the third record, which is the walk-in clinic, is 5/14. However, there's an additional record you sent me that is not in this packet.
Oh. And can you remind me the date of that other record?
That's 3/29. 5/4. There's 5/14. You do not have 5/23.
Okay. Can we have exhibit 4/33, please?
You may.
Yeah.
Okay.
I want the record to be clear, but you just handed the witness and she said yeah. So if you just clarify for the record what just happened.
Thank you, Your Honor. And is that, what I just handed you, is that exhibit 4/33?
Yes, it is. That's the last visit in the clinic with me.
Thank you. And are these records all related to Rice's being prescribed, being put on, and were all related to the medication? Fluoxetine?
Yes, they are.
Thank you. I'd like to offer exhibit 4/39.
Any objections to exhibit?
No objections.
4/39. No objection. Exhibit number 4/39 is admitted.
Thank you. And so, going back to, actually, as you recall, can you just kind of briefly walk us through why Rice was prescribed this medication? I believe your record, the latest one, kind of is pretty thorough in terms of why it was prescribed and the symptoms. Is that your recollection?
Mm-hmm. So, on 3/29/2022, I met with Rice. This was recommended, and this appointment was made by the dad to initiate depression medication based upon the Seattle Children's visit on March 12, 2022, in which Seattle Children's makes a recommendation for this teen to go on a medication trial. In this recommendation, the outpatient team members of Seattle Children's recommended fluoxetine be considered as a first-line medication for this patient to start at 10 milligrams and titrate up over 3 to 4 weeks and then moved to 20 milligrams with a final dosage somewhere between 20 to 60 milligrams. There were also other recommendations for this teen based upon Seattle Children's to improve sleep time, continue with the WISE program, for Rice's parents to improve some health practices at home with regular sleep time, improve sleep since Rice was staying up very late at night, limit the screen time, improve nutrition, regular exercise, provide social support, and peer support through school. Rice has an IEP and a 504 plan at school for them to, you know, give her additional help at school for support for, you know, depression, emotional regulation, anxiety, and such. And so at that visit on 329, when we went through the recommendations, we did another baseline PHQ-9, which is a depression scale, and a GAD-7 to reassess before initiating the start of this medication, so we had a baseline. That, in fact, was done. The depression scale totaled 14. Her GAD-7 totaled 7. Based upon those recommendations and the recommendations of Seattle Children's, we proceeded with starting with the medication. I spoke with Rice and Dad alone together in the exam room. And then after going over the recommendations of starting this medication, the fact that we would all have to be on the same team giving the medication consistently, that parents would need to give the medication that the teen could not self-medicate, we moved forward. I then had Dad go out and sit in the waiting room and then brought Mom in the room and explained the same plan of care with Mom and Rice together. In the end, the prescription was sent to the pharmacy, asking the pharmacy to make two bottles, separate the medication so each parent would have a supply, and also make the teen a follow-up appointment for 4 weeks later.
You mentioned that it's your understanding that Rice has an IEP and a 504 at school?
Yes.
And you,
that 504 plan is for social emotional support and such. That is frequently done for kids with medical diagnoses that might affect their classroom performance. And oftentimes, you know, that can provide that teen or that student a place to go when they're overwhelmed at school. Accommodations are made with the family and the teen and the school counselor together to provide support for the student in the school.
And what causes you to believe that Rice actually has a 504 plan?
From speaking to Dad and such. And that the child is also enrolled in the WISE program.
And your record indicates that Dad reported that Rice was not in the WISE program. I'm sorry, your record being Exhibit 433. So when you said, and Rice is in the WISE program, were you following up on that being a recommendation that Rice is in, or that Rice was in?
No, Rice is enrolled in the WISE program. At that visit, I document that. The teen is enrolled in the WISE and intensive wraparound mental health program. It's documented on 329's visit.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm looking at Exhibit 433, which is dated 5/23/22.
So the 433 visit, and your question is?
You just mentioned that Rice is in the WISE program, but this record, dated 5/23/22, Dad reports that Rice is no longer in the WISE program. And so I was just trying to clarify when you said Rice is in the WISE program. I was.
I think that counselor had gone or left, and they were waiting for another counselor to replace that person. We talked about additional counseling. I offered counseling through our program, at our clinic. The family had also utilized Consejo, so we talked about, you know, who might be the best clinic to follow Rice. You know, you guys have used a lot of clinics over the years, and oftentimes it hasn't been consistent, or therapists leave, or there's a lot of turnover. I offered, you know, choices at that point.
Okay. And so your record is pretty clear as to what you understood based on what was reported to you. And so I think the record kind of speaks for itself in some of those areas. I'd like to, because we're going at noon, I don't want to keep you any longer than is necessary. I'd like to ask you about what the guardian ad litem, Ms. Cynthia Johnson, said about your conversation in Exhibit 438. And did you have a chance to look through that?
I did read it.
Okay. And was there anything that stood out for you in terms of your conversation or with Ms. Johnson, or her understanding of the report being accurate or not accurate?
Now, when the guardian ad litem called, you know, that guardian ad litem asked me many questions regarding the case and was going to get medical records and such, and wanted to know about the interactions and such, and asked me many different questions. She did not tell me some of the conversations of the school. I was able to read that in this document. I don't have there is no date on when that person went to the middle school, what the date of that was. But interesting that Chloe had been having thoughts of blood, and more blood, that Chloe had never expressed that in any of our office visits or expressed it prior to the start of medication. And that she'd experienced thoughts while at her father's house, but didn't tell her dad. Okay, and instead she waited until she came to your house, and then came to your house, and at no time did you call me to tell me that she was having thoughts of blood or some kind of hallucination or worried she was going to hurt herself. I didn't receive any phone call from you. I believe you know I work Monday through Wednesday, and I find it interesting that even though she had those side effects, there was no call to me, and you didn't go to the walk-in clinic until a Saturday.
Okay, so, I'm sorry.
So there's a delay.
You're taking the report at face value, as if it were accurate. My question was, in terms of your conversation with Ms. Johnson, specifically on page 3, line 19, where you said, I am backing up out of this case. I believe your record actually said, and you told me that you were retiring.
The last clinic visit that's in your documents here, which is the 5, which is the last one, 5/23. With my visit with Dad that day, after she had been off medications and withdrawn in the walk-in clinic on the 14th, DC'd because of a question of a side effect. Dad and I visited. I redid her assessment of her depression and anxiety and talked with him and said, I don't want to restart medicine at this time, that her scores had actually improved. Her anxiety and depression scores had improved. Her depression was down to 6. Her anxiety score was down to 4. So at that point, I was not willing, and nor did she need medication at that time. And so the discussion was about making sure that dad went and continued counseling support for the teen, especially during this trial and the difficulty the kids are having being stuck in the middle between you and dad. This has caused great distress to the kids. And so I talked to him about that, told him he needed to find a therapist. I would put a referral through to Mason Health if he would like, or they could go to Conseo or find another one. He chose that he was going to do take a different path, didn't want a referral from me that day. I told him we were more than happy to put one through if he changed his mind, but that in the next 30 days I would be retiring, and so therefore follow-up appointments should be made with Dr. Tulidar, since Dr. Tulidar also sees her brother and such and is familiar with the family. And so that I was stepping back, I told dad I was there in clinic still to be of a support and a guide, but that I would either, if they wanted to pursue other additional medication management, then it would be done through the mental health nurse practitioners, but I was not willing to go through this anymore.
So it wasn't that you were retiring, it was...
Retiring there. And I couldn't see it through. So when one wants to start something, I couldn't see it through because I'd be leaving, so I didn't want to make decisions based upon the future that it would be better handled if you utilized a different provider who would be there permanently or her could foresee it through.
Okay. That makes sense.
We worked very hard through the course of this to try to communicate clearly and put a tremendous amount of effort through communicating not only to dad, but also to you. And I wasn't responsible to communicate through you, but I oftentimes took your phone calls, answered your questions, spent extra time to try to make sure I kept you in the loop of everything that was going on.
And I appreciate that. I'm not sure
right.
I let you
Dad
know.
Has the medical decision
okay,
making
so
in this,
point, this
case.
At this point, we'll have the witness answer the questions. Go ahead, Ms. Bosch, any further questions?
Okay, I'm hearing a lot of frustration and emotion about this.
Oh, yes.
And what I'm understanding is you're taking the information that has been provided to you by Mr. Knight and the information in this report at face value, and how much of that is what's fueling what I'm seeing.
It's not. Okay, I do my job. I do the job to best of my ability. And I've made all these recommendations and followed through on the plan of care for your teen based upon the Seattle Children's Report and recommendations for starting an antidepressant medicine for your child who has anxiety, depression, emotional dysregulation. Yes, I did all that. I followed through to the best of my ability.
And I'm sorry if I was unclear. I wasn't questioning the quality of your care or your decisions. I'm wondering what the basis for your understanding is. You mentioned the Seattle Children's,
mm-hmm.
and there's a lot of information in there, and what's an exhibit here. You mentioned that you received information from Mr. Knight.
Who is her father? Who has all the medical, legal decision making? Yep.
And why do you believe that is?
You share custody and the child goes back and forth every week. Dad has the medical decision making based upon what he's told us. He has full medical decision making.
And that wasn't my question, but I'll withdraw my question. Rice is turned 13 on May 11th.
Yes.
And sorry.
Did you request some water?
Oh, please, thank you.
There's a picture right there. It should have water. You have to work around this thing.
No problem. Thank you very much. Thanks.
Okay, Ms. Boss, go ahead.
Okay, so just to clarify, when do you think I learned about Rice's symptoms on the medication?
Pardon?
Just to clarify, when do you think I learned about Rice's symptoms on the medication?
Objection, speculation.
The reaction, the blood, you're just, what symptoms?
Yeah, the blood portion. I mean, you seem really angry that I didn't contact you. When do you believe Rice informed me?
Whenever you got cut, it must be the, let's see, when's the exchange? Let's, I can't tell, I don't know the exact days you guys go back and forth. Let's see.
And just to assist, we exchange on Mondays. If I received mm-hmm. Rice on Monday, and is it your belief or assumption that Rice informed me immediately on Monday?
No, this came from where, this came from that report.
Exactly.
I get a notification by the nurse practitioner that you came to the walk-in clinic, and that's how I learned of that.
Okay. Do you, when a parent calls the after-hours nurse line, is that logged into your system and recorded?
Any nurse call is recorded.
So the after-hours ask a nurse kind of thing? Is that available in the regular records? I've tried.
After, now, if you talk to online, I have clinic phone notes. There is, what day did you call in?
Friday evening, immediately after Rice.
What's the date?
Stop for a moment. We're not having a conversation here. You ask questions, you answer questions, so go ahead and ask the next question, Ms. Buff.
I'm sorry, the question was, did you receive any notifications? Do you routinely get notifications from those after-hours online service call nurse people? Or is that a separate system than the medical records through Mason General?
After, the messages are taken by after hours and forwarded to the clinics.
And how does a person get access to those?
HIM department is how you get message, how you, and it depends on whether or not those messages, I don't know that phone messages are, I don't know that you can request them. I wouldn't know. That
okay,
would have to,
okay.
That'd be a question to Laura Grubb, to our HIM department, because I don't know if those things are part of the document that you can get a hold of.
Okay, but
I don't know.
It's your understanding that sometimes they can be.
If it's addressed to me.
Oh, and so.
If it's not addressed to me, if it's a question about Tylenol, if it's a question of something, it will go to the nurse care center.
Oh, okay.
The nursing care center question, it receives phone calls from the outside, and then from the nursing care center, if it's something the physician needs to see or approve or give medication or whatever, it's forwarded on to that team.
Okay, so when a parent calls and says, we've got this situation, what do I do? That doesn't necessarily trigger someone to send a message to you. The parent needs to be more specific with, here's her provider.
To what team and who's your provider,
right?
And if you want to talk to the provider, or is it just a nurse question?
Oh, okay. Thank you for clarifying that. And so if, when Rice told me on Friday evening.
What's the date?
Friday the 13th of May.
Mm-hmm.
And I immediately called the Ask a Nurse line, and they directed us to go to the walk-in clinic right away because it's the weekend. That's the only option to do that in the morning. Does that indicate that my actions are actually maybe appropriate rather than however you would characterize?
Yeah, I mean, you know, yes, you receive information, then it is appropriate to go through and either try to access the provider or go to a clinic or go to the local emergency room if there's concerns.
Okay, so that action was appropriate. And because Rice turned 13 on May 11th and we went, they reported this to me on the 13th and I brought Rice in so that they could manage this,
mm-hmm.
try to talk to
mm-hmm.
providers. Is that appropriate given Rice's newly turned 13?
It's appropriate to bring the child in if there is a concern regarding medication side effect.
Okay. And if the child has a hard time articulating or is embarrassed or whatnot, is it appropriate for a parent to aid in that conversation?
Parents will oftentimes give input into that. Provider may ask the teen individual questions by themselves,
okay.
Ask them to complete forms about their depression, anxiety, or symptoms.
Okay. And if I was, or Rice and I were both directed to immediately follow up with you first thing Monday morning, I'm sorry, do you recall my leaving messages for you first thing Monday morning about this? And you're struggling to get the right phone number to call me back, and the phone call was 4:30. Is that something that you recall?
Yes.
Okay. And if all of those facts are true, does it sound like maybe my actions were appropriate?
Yes, you called, and it's in the records that you
okay.
called.
And actually, I don't have a record of the phone call conversation between you and I. Did you direct me at that time as to what to do?
I got a hold of you finally after going through the records and finding an additional phone call, additional phone number, because I made several attempts that day trying to talk to you to follow up, to discuss the fluoxetine adjustment and discuss the visit to the urgent care clinic.
Mm-hmm.
So it was, that evening it was 16:57 when
mm-hmm.
I made two phone calls, finally got through to the final number, spoke to you, Angie. At that time you had custody of the kids and you were supposed to hand the kids back that night at 6 p.m. And such. You had tried to file to get custody of the kids so you didn't have to return them back, but you were too late trying to get that filed and such. And so the kids were going to have to be returned back to dad that night. The urgent care clinic gave you some directions on dropping the fluoxetine. And I told you about how long the half-life was of that medicine and how to discontinue it.
And do you recall when you were attempting to call me, did the Mason General system have the wrong number in place for me? Was it instead of 970, was it 470?
Who took the message had put your phone number in there as 470-8267. Instead of 970. So after I couldn't get a hold through that number, I went back through other messages to hunt and look for your number to take the time to connect to you.
And that sounds really like it was frustrating for you. A lot of extra time and hassle with someone making an error and some miscommunications.
Well, it's important to connect, and so if I have a message, I need to connect, so it was like, go look for the phone number.
And with this medication, is it unusual to prescribe an antidepressant for someone and have some curious thoughts, some odd side effects, and then have to maybe try another one? Is it unusual to have to change new medication when someone's never taken an antidepressant before?
Yes, because people can have side effects. And so if you have side effects and you still, and it's still deemed that you need additional medication, then we will consider starting a second medicine.
Okay. I'm sorry, just to back up, I asked, is it unusual? And you said yes, because, and maybe I wasn't clear. So it's not unusual, is what I'm hearing, that sometimes the first one doesn't work and we'll try something else?
That can happen.
Okay. All right. And is it possible that a teen or youth who might have memory problems identified through a school evaluation might have a hard time remembering all of the details at an appointment, and is that uncommon that children, youth, don't always get everything right in reporting symptoms and what happened over the past couple of weeks or months?
It depends upon the age of the child. So yes, children don't always tell you everything, which is why you have to question parents too.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
No further questions.
Mr. Knight, do you have any questions of this witness?
Yes, I do.
Hello, Treats.
Hi.
Isn't it true that on the fall on the 16th of May, I believe it is, that you called Mr. Knight at work, and when you had found out about the walk-in clinic appointment with Chloe?
Did I call him? Yes, I called him.
And you had concerns of why the medication had been, or how Ms. Voss had been stating that she was going to titrate off due to alleged symptoms that Chloe had supposedly have told Ms. Voss? From what you had heard or had read through the walk-in clinic's report?
Right. I was concerned about what happened at the walk-in clinic, wanted to follow up with Dad to see if, you know, there were concerns at his end, and also to inform him of what had happened while the child was in custody of Mom that weekend, and the plan of going forward.
Okay. Isn't it true that over the years you've called Mr. Knight to inform him of issues that Ms. Voss had done previously?
I oftentimes, if I receive information from ERs or other clinics that the kids have been in clinic, that I will usually follow up a phone call if a child has been seen in another clinic or ER and follow up with Mr. Knight, yes.
Okay. Isn't it true that Mr. Knight did not report any negative side effects reported by by Chloe or Rice, and matter of fact made statements that even the counselor was getting positive results when speaking with Rice about the medication?
Yes, Mr. Knight did say that.
Did it cause you any concern that Ms. Voss
was titrating Chloe off of medication simply by the advice of a walk-in clinic provider who had no history, no known history of the family, and with Ms. Voss then attempting to also restrain Mr. Knight from getting Chloe so that she could finish titrating her off. Did that bring you any concern?
The concern was was going over the instructions of how to discontinue the medication, and wanted to, since I was the one that prescribed it, give further instructions on how to do that.
So, Ms. Voss called you and specifically asked you how she could titrate Chloe off of the medications with simply by the recommendation of the walk-in clinic care provider. Is this true?
Yes. And I gave her additional instructions on how to discontinue that.
Was you recommending that?
Yes. Because you don't need to titrate down the medicine. It has a long half-life, and because of its long half-life, that means the metabolites will stay in your body for a period of time. You can just, at the dose she was at, could just discontinue it.
Wasn't the dose she was at, was at the starter dose?
No, she was at 20 milligrams.
Hadn't that just been titrated up the previous week?
Yeah.
So technically she just barely got into the 20 milligrams?
Right.
So the amount of medication that was in her system was not at the proper level to provide adequate, or what was desired for from the medication?
Let's see. The med was started, or the prescription was written on 3/29. All right. So you need 3 to 4 weeks to titrate the initial starting dosage before you can increase it. So the patient had been on it, you count those weeks up, at least, you know, and we had to extend it some to give you additional medication before we saw you in clinic. So the patient was actually on it, you know, for the 4 weeks before we went up.
With the increase to 20,
mm-hmm.
the amount of time between increasing from 10 to 20, was that in a sufficient time to titrate her to the 20 milligram dosage to see what kind of result comes from it?
Yes, plenty of time.
Do you think Chloe would have benefited from staying on the medication for a minimum of 6 months?
The decision, could she have benefited staying on medication? The problem was we had the side effects, so it was stopped. At the reassessment, the score was low enough that the patient could just continue doing therapy at that point.
Is there a chance that now that Chloe Rice has titrated, Chloe Rice has titrated off of it, and the half-life of the medication wears off, is there a possibility that Rice could become more depressed and anxious again?
That half-life, so when it was DC'd in the clinic on the 14th, they told mom to titrate down. If she stopped after the phone call on the 17th, there's still a half-life period, and that half-life could last. So it's 3 to 4 days to get out of the initial, to get out of that system, but the metabolites can last up to 2 to 3 weeks before it's totally gone from your system. So there's no measurable drug.
Is it common for a person who has anxiety and depression to the extent that Chloe had been diagnosed to be able to take this medication for approximately 5 weeks and then not have to take medication again? is this a common thing for a person who is diagnosed with an anxiety and depression to the level that Chloe was diagnosed to be on a medication for approximately 5 to 6 weeks and then come off of it and be okay?
Is it possible?
Is it possible?
Sure, it's possible.
Is it a likely?
I don't know. Normally, kids are on it for a period of time.
Is the minimum time for a psychotropic drug like that for usage a minimum of 6 months usually?
About.
So usually there is no benefit from a medication if it isn't taken for at least the minimum prescribed
right.
amount of time?
Yeah, you have to take it as directed for that period of time.
For the benefit to be taken?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I can't remember the doctor's name that Chloe's going to be seeing now. I'm bad with names. Dr.
Tulidar,
yes. In the past, when I brought Chloe into Mason Clinic and you were on vacation or something, Chloe had seen Dr. Tulidar, and he had recommended antidepressants a year ago. Did you see the notes that he had made on that visit from last year?
I don't recall that.
Okay. No further questions.
Ms. Voss, any further questions of this witness?
I do. Yes, I'm sorry. It's 12:30. I'm trying to make it really quick here. So when you said you had concerns related to a question about what Mr. Knight called alleged symptoms, can you explain what your concerns were? Was your concern that the alleged symptoms were not accurately being reported? Was your concern regarding, this patient's having side effects or symptoms? Can you better describe that?
No.
Am I
what he just said?
No, I'm unclear as to...
I'm unclear of what you're asking. I remember what
sorry.
He said, she said, what? I don't get it.
I'm sorry. Well, let me rephrase the question. When Mr. Knight asked if you had concerns about the alleged symptoms that were reported, and you said yes, you had concerns. Can you describe the nature of your concern?
Right.
Was your concern that your patient had symptoms, maybe this medication might be a problem, or was your concern that, oh no, mom's saying something that might not be true? So I guess
no, of course I have concerns that Rice had a question of a possible side effect to the medication.
Okay, thank you for clarifying that. Not everyone, reads things the same. You mentioned that you had to extend the you wanted Rice on it for 4 weeks and to have a follow-up. Was there a follow-up scheduled for April 20th? That Mr. Knight missed?
There was a 4-week visit.
And Mr. Knight didn't bring Rice in?
I had to make another appointment. And I don't know if it was because of one of your court dates, but yes, it did get rescheduled.
And?
Because I also had to write an additional prescription to make sure that you both had enough medicine to make it to the following visit.
Right, right.
That's April 25th.
You
and it got rescheduled to May the 4th.
Okay.
And I gave an additional 14-day supply to the pharmacy to make sure you both had enough medicine and that the child would not run out.
Thank you. So, Mr. Knight asked about the chance that Rice could become depressed again, not being on the medication. Is the medication the, I'm sorry, let me back up. If Rice's symptoms, their, I'm sorry, their depression, anxiety, is based on some of these things that you mention in your 523 record, such as identifying as non-binary, preferring the name Rice and pronoun they, them, and not being respected or supported in one household, and if teasing and bullying at school are contributing, if there are so many other things you indicate here. We've got bad sleep hygiene, not enough exercise, not if there are all these environmental external factors, is the medication the only way to deal with those things?
No, medication is not the only way to deal with it. That's the point of, you know, doing therapy, and also parents following through to support the child. So that includes, you know, good, adequate sleep to make sure that children get, you know, a good 9 to 10 hours sleep, that they have a good nutrition diet, that as parents we try to reduce stress in the household, that we make sure kids are getting regular exercise, that they have peer support. All of those things are important. Medicine is only one little small component of the treatment plan.
Thank you. Is vitamin D deficiency also a contributing factor for depression and anxiety that you know of?
Can be.
Okay. Have you heard of small bacterial, small intestinal bacterial overgrowth, or SIBO, also contributing to mood or anxiety issues?
A small bowel?
Small intestinal bacterial
overgrowth. No, I'm not aware.
It's kind of an obscure thing. Okay, I think that's it for my questions.
Any further questions?
Good. Any objections? This witness being excused.
No objections, Your Honor.
Okay.
Thank you.
You are excused.
Thank you very much.
I can take those.
Now I want to make sure you get back just yours, not mine.
Right. And we'll make sure of that. I hope you enjoy your retirement.
This should be yours. One, two, three.
Yeah, ours should have the sticker on top here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
433, 439, and 438.
Okay. And then need to have you make your way over to the clerk, and she has a piece of paper that you need to sign indicating that you were here. Okay, and we are going to recess for lunch. You have a witness scheduled for 1:30?
Correct.
Okay, so we're not going to start right up at 1:30, but we'll be close to and have your witness ready at 1:30. We'll probably start about 1:40, I guess. Okay?
Thank you,
Court is in recess.
And I'm sorry, you confirmed you got all of the exhibits before they leave? Thank you.
Okay.
I didn't hear.